Assalamualaikum. This is lecture 21 of Data Security and Encryption, and in this lecture we are going to discuss about some other public key crypto systems. In this lecture we are going to discuss a number of public key algorithms. The first one is Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithms, and we will be discussing about the algorithm and its protocols. The second algorithm is Al-Gamal cryptographic system. However, most of the lecture will be comprised of the elliptic arithmetic curves algorithms and cryptography problems. And finally, there will be discussion of pseudo random number generator based on an asymmetric cipher. So the first algorithm in discussion is the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So as the name suggests, this algorithm is used for exchanging keys between two or more users. So it was the first published public key algorithm, and a number of commercial products employ this key exchange technique to exchange the keys. So the purpose is to enable two users to securely exchange a key that can then be used for further symmetric encryption of messages. On the other hand, the algorithm itself is limited to the exchange of secret values only, and there is no further communication or values are used for the communication except from the secret keys. And its effectiveness depends on the difficulty of computing discrete logarithms. Discrete logarithms are defined in terms of primitive roots, and a primitive root of a prime number p is 1 whose powers modulo p generate all the integers from 1 to p minus 1. That is, if a is a number, a is a primitive root of a prime number p, then the numbers a mod p, a square mod p, and a raised to power p minus 1 mod p are distinct and consistent of the integers from 1 through p minus 1 in some permutation. So for any integer b and a primitive root a of the prime number p, we can find the unique exponent I such that that number b is equal to a raised to power I mod p, where I is a number from 0 to p minus 1. So recall our equation from lecture number 5 to find out the primitive root. In case we had an equation b is equivalent to a raised to power I mod p, and this I is in the range from 0 to p minus 1. This exponent I is referred to as discrete logarithms of b for the base a mod p. So we can express the values using d log a comma p into b. So figure on the right hand side of this slide, let me clear up, summarizes the Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm. For this scheme, there are two publicly known numbers, a prime number q and an integer alpha, that is a primitive root of q. Suppose the user A wish to create a shared key. So at the first step, the user selects, generates a private key xA such that xA is less than the number prime number q, and computes a key y of a that is equal to a raised to power x a mod q. Similarly, the user b independently selects a random integer x b, and which is less than again the prime number q, and computes the key y b is equal to a raised to power x b mod q. So each side keeps the value of x as private and makes the value of y available to the publicly to the other side. Therefore, x of a is a's private key and y of a is a's corresponding public key. Similarly for b, user a computes the key is equal to y of b raised to power x of a mod q, and the user b computes the key y of a x raised to power b. So these two calculations produce a similar result that will be a private and a public key for the both of the users. So the protocol presented in the last slide is insecure against a man in the middle attack. Suppose the user A and the B wish to exchange key, and there is a user named D or Darth is an attacker. The attack proceeds as described in this figure. So first of all, the attacker Darth prepares the attack by generating two random private keys named as XD1 and XD2, and then computing the corresponding public keys YD1 and YD2. Now, when the user A transmits Y of A to the user B, the Darth user intercepts Y of A and transmits Y of D1 to the user B. Darth also calculates the key 2, that is equal to Y of A x D2 mod Q. Bob receives the key from the Darth and calculates the key which is dependent on the Y of D1. Bob transmits Y of B to the Alice. However, Darth intercepts Y of B and transmits Y of D2 to the Alice, and Darth calculates the key 1 as well. Now Alice receives the key from the Darth and generates the key. So at this point, the Bob and the Alice think that they share a secret key, but instead Bob and Darth share a secret key K1, and the Alice and Darth share a secret key K2. All the future communications between Bob and Alice will be compromised. Now, when the Alice sends an encrypted message, the Darth intercepts the encrypted message and decrypts it to recover the original message. The Darth sends the Bob or Alice an encrypted message using any of the key, where M is an message. So in the first case, the Darth simply wants to listen to the communication without altering it, and in the second case, the Darth wants to modify the message going to the Bob, so he has the access to the both keys. So the key exchange protocol is vulnerable to such an attack because it does not authenticate the participants, and this vulnerability can overcome with the use of digital signatures and public key certificates. And these two topics will be discussed in the upcoming lectures. So the second algorithm in discussion in public key cryptography is AlGamal, and it was announced in 1984 by T. AlGamal, and it is based on public key scheme on discrete logarithms closely related to the previous algorithms we have discussed, and it is used in the digital signature standard and the SS and SMIME email standard, that is the email standard for the emails. Then global elements are prime numbers Q and A again, which is a primitive root of Q. Security is based on the difficulty of computing discrete logarithms, so it is very much similar to the previous algorithm. So this algorithm shows the working of AlGamal algorithm or cryptography system. As with the Diffie-Hellman, the global element of AlGamal are a prime number Q and an alpha, which is a primitive root of Q. So user A generates a private public key as described here. So you can generate a random integer x of a which is less than q minus 1. Then you can compute the key y of a by a raised to power x of a mod q, and then you calculate the public key for that is based on the private and public key. So a's private key is x of a and a's public key is q alpha y of a. So any user b that uses that has the access to the a's public key can encrypt the message. So as in this case, the encryption is shown by Bob with the public key of the Alice. So the first step states that the represent the message as an integer m, which will be a number range from 0 to q minus 1. So plain text is referred as m is less than q. Then you have to select a random integer k which is less than q or greater than 1. So you compute the one time key, that is k is equal to y raised to power k mod q. The next step is to encrypt the message as a pair of integers c1 comma c2, where c1 is equal to a raised to power k mod q and c2 is equal to km mod q. And finally, the ciphertext is the combination of a pair c1 and c2. So user A recovers the plain text in this manner. Then ciphertext is received in the form of c1 and c2. The user has to calculate the key by using the private key, that is xa. So k is equal to c1 power xa mod q, and plain text generated will be m, that is used with the c2 k minus 1 mod q. The next algorithm is the elliptic curve cryptography, and it is based on elliptic curve arithmetic. Most of the products and standards that use the public key cryptography for encryption and digital signatures use the RSA algorithm. So the key length for the secure RSA use has increased over recent years, and this has put a heavier processing load on the application using RSA. So this burden has the ramification especially for electronic commerce sites that conduct the large numbers of secure transactions. So a competing system that challenges the RSA is named as elliptic curve cryptography. Elliptic curve cryptography, in short terms ECC, is showing up a standardization efforts, including the IEEE P1363 standard for the public key cryptography. So these principles, principal attraction of ECC is it appears to offer equal security for a far smaller size of the key. So the explanation of ECC is fundamentally more difficult than the RSA or Diffie-Hellman, and a full mathematical description is beyond the scope of this course. However, to give you a small idea about the working of ECC, we begin with a brief review of the concept of abelian group. So recall from the lecture number 11 about the abelian group and the fields. An abelian group is a set of binary operations denoted by a dot that associates to each order pair AB of the elements in the G of an element A dot B in G such that the following axioms are obeyed. So if you have two numbers, binary operation, to have elements combined with the binary operation, it must hold the property of closures. So if A and B belongs to G, the resultant will also be in the G. So these also hold the associative properties for all the operations and they hold the identity element, that is, there is an element E in the G such that if you multiply an element with the E, the result will not change and it will be in the G for all elements. And there should exist an inverse for each A in the G. There is an element A inverse in the G such that if you multiply A with the A inverse, the resultant should be an identity element. And it also holds the commutative property. So a number of public key ciphers are based on the use of an abelian group. So in general terms, an elliptic curve is defined as an operation in two variables with coefficients. For cryptography, the variables and the coefficients are restricted to elements in a finite field, which results in the definition of a finite abelian group. So elliptic curves are not ellipses. They are named because they are described by cubic equations, similar to those used for calculating the circumference of an ellipse. So in general, cubic equation for elliptic curves take the form as described here. So an elliptic curve equation may take the form y square plus axy plus by, which should be equal to x cube plus cx square plus dx plus e. So where a, b, c, d, e are real numbers and x and y take on the values of the real numbers. So for our purpose, it is sufficient to limit ourselves to the equation in the form of y square, which must be equal to x cube ax plus b. Such equations are said to be cubic or of degree 3 because the highest exponent contains that is equal to 3. Also included in the definition of an elliptic curve is a single element denoted by O. It's called the point at infinity or the zero point, which we will discuss shortly. So to plot an elliptic curve, we need to compute the value of variable y, which can be found out by taking the square root of this equation, x cube plus ax plus b. So for given values of a and b, in this case, the plot consists of positive and negative values of y for each value of x. Therefore, each curve is a symmetric about y is equal to 0. This figure shows two examples of elliptic curves. So as you can see, the formula sometimes produces weird looking curves. You can consider the set of point E, A, B consisting of all the points x, y that satisfy the first equation written here together with the element O. So using different value of the pair A, B result in a different set of our elliptic curves. So using this terminology, the two curves in the figure presented are from the set minus 1 to 0 and 1 to 1 respectively. Elliptic curve cryptography uses the curves whose variables and coefficients are finite. So two families of elliptic curves are used in cryptographic application. One is the binary curves over G of f 2 raised to power m, and the second one is prime curves over zp, which is a set of real numbers. So in this case, you can use a cubic equation in which the variables and coefficient all take on the values of set of integers from 0 to p minus 1 and which calculations are performed on modulo p. So it is a best for software applications. However, if you want to perform elliptic curve on hardware application, binary curve over g of f to raise to power m is considered. So variables and coefficient all take on the values in g f to raise to power m, and in calculation are performed over the fields g f to raise to power m. So if you recall that a finite field g f to raise to power m consists of 2 raised to power m elements together with the addition and multiplication operations that can be defined over polynomials. So it was discussed in the lecture with the fields. So for elliptic curves over g f 2 raised to power m, you can use a cubic equation in which the variable and coefficients all take on the values g f 2 raised to power m for some number m. So calculations are performed using the rules of arithmetic in g f 2 raised to power m, and the form of cubic equation appropriate for the cryptographic application for elliptic curves is somewhat different from than the g of p. So it is understood that the variable x and y and the coefficient a and b are elements of g f 2 raised to power m, and the calculations are performed in the same field. So in this form, the form of the equation is represented as y square plus xy, and which is equal to finding out the value of x cube plus ax plus b for any arbitrary values of a and b. So addition operation in elliptic curve cryptography is the counterpart of the modular multiplication in RSA. Multiple addition is the counterpart of modular exponentiation. So to form a cryptographic system using elliptic curves, you need to find out a hard problem corresponding to the factor of the product of two primes or taking the discrete logarithm. So consider the equation Q is equal to KP, where Q and P belongs to a prime curve, and it will be easy to compute Q given that a key and a P, but it will be hard to find out key given the input and output values, and it is known as the elliptic curve logarithm problem. So in real applications, K would be so large that it is to make the brute force approach infeasible. So the right side of the slide shows a key exchange between the user A and B, and it can be accomplished in this form. So at the start, the user A selects an integer n of A which is less than the number n. This is A's private key. A then generates a public key P of A, which is equal to n of A multiplied by G. The public key is the point in the E, Q, A, P. And the G is the point on the elliptic curve whose order is large value n. Similarly, B selects the private key B and B by which is less than n, and the public key B multiplying n b with the g. So A generates the secret key k n a multiplied by p b, and B generates the secret key k n b multiplied by p a. So several approaches using elliptic curves has been analyzed. So the first task in this system is to encode the plain text message to be sent as an XY point in PM, that is elliptic curve points. And these points will be encrypted as a ciphertext and subsequently decrypted. Note that you cannot simply encode the message as an XY coordinate of a point, because Not all such coordinates are in the form of elliptic curves. So the next step is to select a suitable curve and a point G as in Diffie-Hellman algorithm. So as with the key exchange system, an encryption and decryption system requires a point G and an elliptic curve group E of Q as parameters. So each user A selects a private key N of A and generates the public key P of A by multiplying its private key with the point in the G as described by this equation. So to encrypt and send a message P of M, which is an elliptic curve prime, to B, the user A chooses a random positive integer K and produces the ciphertext C of M consisting of the pair of points, which is calculated using this equation. To decrypt the ciphertext, B multiplies the first point in the pair by B's secret key and subtracts the result from the second point as described by this equation. So security of the elliptic curve cryptography depends on how difficult it is to determine the number k, given that kp and p, and it is referred as the difficulty of elliptic curve logarithm problem. And the fastest known technique is referred as Pollard-Rojo method, and compared to factoring, it can be much smaller key size with the RSA than in the elliptic curve cryptography. So for equivalent key lengths, computations are roughly equivalent. Hence, for similar security, ECC offers significant computational advantages. So this table is from the recommendation of the NEST for key management, compares various algorithms by showing comparable key sizes in terms of computational effort for cryptanalysis. As it can be seen, considerably small key size can be used for ECC algorithm than for the RSA algorithm. So based on the analysis, the NIST recommends that at least through 2030, acceptable key lengths from 3072 to 14,360 for the RSA and 256 to 512 for ECC. So this analysis indicates that the equal key lengths in the computational effort required for ECC and RSA is comparable. Therefore, there is computational advantages using the ECC algorithm with the shorter key length than comparable by RSA, which is quite evident in the table. Pseudo-random numbers are also used in asymmetric ciphers. So an asymmetric encryption algorithm produces apparently random output and can be used to build a pseudo-random number generator. However, it is much slower than symmetric algorithms, so they are not used to generate the open-ended pseudo-random number generator bit streams. However, these are useful for creating pseudo-random functions for generating a short pseudo-random bit sequence. So for a sufficient key length, the RSA algorithm is considered secure and it is a good candidate to form the basis of pseudo-random number generator. And such pseudo-random number generator is known as Michaelis-Conner pseudo-random number bit generator. The pseudo-random number generator is described in this slide. As it can be seen that this pseudo-random number generator has much of the same structure as an output feedback mode used in the pseudo-random number generator in the previous few lectures. So in this case, the encryption algorithm is the RSA rather than the symmetric block cipher. Also, a portion of the output is fed back to the next iteration of the encryption algorithm and the remainder of the output is forwarded. So this output is used as pseudo random number bits. The motivation for this separation of the output into two distinct parts is so that the pseudo random number bits from one stage do not provide the input to the next stage. So this separation should contribute to the forward unpredictability for the pseudo random number generation. Pseudo random number generators based on the elliptic curve cryptographies were developed by US NSA National Security Agency, and these are known as dual elliptic curve pseudo random number generator. These are recommended in NIST SP890 as an ANSI standard and ISO standard, and has been some controversy regarding the both the security and efficiency of this algorithm compared to the other alternatives. The only motivation for its use would be that it is used in a system that already implements the elliptic curve cryptography but does not implement any other symmetric, asymmetric or hash cryptographic algorithm that can be used to build a pseudo random number generator. So this concludes today's lecture, and in this lecture we discuss some public key encryption algorithms. Mainly focus of the lecture was on the Diffie-Hellman key exchange protocol, that how two users interchange their key using different algorithms. And in the Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm, we saw the man in the middle attack as a problem which was uncovered by some terms in Al-Gamal cryptographic system. We overview another algorithm known as elliptic curve cryptography, which has very much similarity to the Diffie-Hellman key exchange, and it is based on the elliptic curve arithmetic, and we have seen its implementation on the real number set ZFP and in the form of GFF 2 raised to power m. And finally, we discussed the pseudo random number generation based on asymmetric cipher, and it is used based on the RSA and elliptic curve cryptography. However, it has very limited use in asymmetric algorithms. If you want to study more about the topic, you can read chapter number 10, or you can ask me any questions. Thank you very much.